It's one of the names that is like put out there that you just hear about as being one of those engines for culture.
I think everyone in Australia is aware of Future Classic. They're the best at what they do, especially in Australia.
It's the knowing when no one else knows, right? It's like you can listen to something and be like, this is great, but you need the whole world to agree with you for it to get anywhere.
They've really done well to create this incubator of Australian talent. You know, they've got people like Flume, Jeff Faker, Wafia, Charles Murdoch, Flight Facilities.
You get the impression that that's why they're so successful, because they just have a certain vision for what they want to do and they're totally guided by it.
If you compare to a lot of other sound from electronic scene from every part of the world, there is something really fresh, really particular. It's a mix of influence that you see only in Australia.
There's a kind of freedom to think a bit differently and think new. And Future Classic is certainly part of that wave, I think, of an Australian voice that's coming through with something that feels quite visionary.
This was a compilation of Australian artists, basically, which was the first release.
Do you want to read the tagline there?
Ah, it's terrible. Sophisticated dance floor sounds from Australia.
Yeah.
Basically, no one cared about this record.
Future Classic started really as an outlet for creativity for myself and Jay to make things we wanted to make.
We had already been living together for some time and working on lots of creative projects.
I guess I kind of wanted to have a business. I was passionate about the product. I also knew I wanted to work in music, and I'd been tinkering with making music and I was DJing a lot. I sort of decided that I didn't want to be the artist, that I wanted to be the guy who was organizing.
The last track on this by Touch Sensitive, Body Stop, that was like the first thing in the catalog, which I was like, I love that song.
From my perspective, it was always an art project. It was always just about doing a cool party or having someone cool play or just creating something. Although they have records that are really, really successful, there's also records that, you know, maybe 100 people will buy them. And I think if they like something, they just put it out. That's rare.
We got to the point at Future Classic where Nathan was putting on a lot of club nights and DJing, and I was doing a lot of design work to keep the money coming in.
It really didn't have very sound business logic at the beginning.
We really needed some help, and we couldn't really afford help, but we really needed it.
I've known Jay since I was about 9 or 10 years old. Jay is actually my sister's best friend. I feel like I kind of got a lot of my sort of electronic music education through Nathan. He would be DJing at various parties, and with all of the stuff that they did, Jay would do the artwork and the photography or any of the sort of graphic work on a project.
Future Classic back in the day was a pretty DIY electronic dance label. Really cutting edge deep house and techno and like exploring new things in live music.
The vibe's killing it, man. There's a heaps of good crew here. Like everyone's really vibing, like everyone's happy, and that's what it's all about. The music's so good, bro. Like so much better than anywhere else in Sydney tonight, man.
I became a big fan of electronic music in the mid-90s, living in London, going to the Blue Note where Andrew Weatherall was doing a night and Metalhead, Sunday Sessions, Ninja Tune was doing Stealth, Mowax had a night, like, wow, there's an art house end to electronic music. And when I was watching Nathan and Jay and Chad kind of start up Future Classic, you could just see it was completely informed by the same sorts of things.
They had some parties and we went to the parties.
Yeah, we saw them at parties and then... Yeah. I think their first involvement, like really on an official level, was sitting on the roof where we dragged the couch to the roof.
Yeah.
That kind of led us to adult disco, which was like, we want to do a party that's irreverent. This is where we can have fun with it.
Well, the spirit of it was also like, how do we make a living? Because the records are really niche, the sort of stuff that we like is really underground, and the only way we can make money out of this is when we throw events.
It was poorly planned when you look at it now. Like, we were like, we were trying to do everything at once.
As far as record design went, we became more savvy about being economical, and so we went through a couple of generic sleeves. So we would create a sleeve like this, and then the sticker art would change. So it was all very, like, DIY.
It made it easy for the audience to know if it was a Future Classic release, because a lot of that club fair kind of music, no one's following that artist or knows about it yet, whereas they follow the label. I get permission to love. These releases in the generic sleeve, they sort of caught on at Triple J radio here in Australia, and off the back of that, that gave us more confidence to do fully fledged album campaigns.
I've actually never taught anyone this. I will. Permission to Love is about the night that I asked Jen's parents for their permission to marry their daughter. I couldn't tell her about the song, like about the meaning, until I proposed, and I'm like, hey, by the way. So yeah, it was pretty cool.
I think, I can't remember exactly what year it was, but there was a certain point where they both decided, all right, we're not gonna work our day jobs anymore, we're gonna do Future Classic full time. And I don't think I really understood the gravity of that for them, because it's, you know, it's a big deal to, it's a risk, it's a huge risk.
We felt like we had a lot of experience, we'd done a lot of tours, we'd done numerous club nights. Gradually, certain things started to work. I did know a lot about what was going on with the web and, you know, music and internet radio and how that stuff was changing things. And I didn't know what the answers were, but I was fascinated about what was going on. And it was a really exciting thing to be like, wow, we're not going to buy CDs. People are going to download everything.
Future Classic were running this competition, and it was send in your best original tracks.
I think it was roughly 500 artists submit work, and they had to submit via SoundCloud, which at the time was pretty new.
It was super new. So I sent them in, and Nathan and Chad got back to me, like, yeah, you got runner-up.
I think we had Sleepless up for free for like another year for free download, and then put it up, the EP up on the iTunes store, and then it started charting, even though it was free on SoundCloud, and it sort of started going nuts. At that point, we were just like, oh my gosh, this is something's going on
here. It's clicking.
Yeah.
How people discover music now is so fragmented and different. I think that you have to think a lot more long-term about how you're gonna get people to support artists.
I thought it was really clever how, you know, they always push stuff out first through their channel, and they really spend a lot of time building that up. I'm only young, can't you see?
When I heard his first record, I just thought, I've never heard anything like this. And every single song on the record was unique and had composition, and it was like, I was blown away by a whole album.
What's really remarkable is that Never Be Like You seemed to get sort of an instantaneous thumbs up around the world globally.
You know, good music is good music. It's not about sound or, you know, what's in the charts at the time. You know, it's either passionate and genuine, or it's a load of corporate bullshit.